want to welcome you today to the homegoing celebration for Joan Tyson. My name is Stan Barong, and I'm senior pastor here at Glen Haven Baptist Church. And it is truly an honor and a privilege to be able to have Miss Joan's homegoing service here at Glen Haven Baptist Church. Bob and Joan and Steve joined Glen Haven August the 11th of 1991, and we've been privileged to have them as members of our church. Stephanie joined our church in 2002, and so it certainly is a great privilege for us to be able to have them here as a part of our church family. I want to welcome not only those of you who are here, but by live streaming, I want to welcome those in Honduras and Nicaragua that are watching this service at this time as well. I would say the only thing I know to say to you in Spanish, buenos dias. That's it. That's about it. Brother Randy Bell can do a lot more in that language than I can. But it is an honor to be able to also welcome them into this service, and they're watching this at this time as well. Joan Marilyn Coslow Tyson. We know where's Miss Joan. She was born September 6, 1936. Yesterday was her 80th birthday. She went home to be with the Lord September 3rd. She was preceded in death by her precious husband, Bob Tyson, also by her brothers, Harvey Coslow, T.W. Coslow, and Glenn Ira Coslow Sr. She is survived by her two sons and daughter-in-law, Philip and Olga Tyson of Villa Rica, Steve Tyson of Villa Rica, five grandchildren, Stephanie, Philip Jr., Michael, Ashley, Brianna, Brandon, and several nieces, nephews, and sister-in-laws also survived. We're going to open the service now with a word of prayer. After that, we'll have a song by our choir. And then after that, Miss Jane Keel, a dear friend and a wonderful singer of Miss Jones, and a wonderful singer that we've known for many years, will be coming and sharing. Then I will be coming back after that. Then our choir will be coming after that. And then Jason and Missy Waldrop, longtime friends also. And then Randy Bell, and then Miss Sandy Payton, a wonderful singer, will be coming and sharing, and former director of music here at Glen Haven Baptist Church. And then video tribute by Stephanie Tyson, and then Pastor Ralph, our pastor emeritus, will be also doing the closing message at that time. Let's go to the Lord in prayer this morning as we begin. Father, thank you so much, Lord, that for us at Glen Haven, we came to know this precious family in the late 60s. We thank you, Father, that you brought them our way. And from that, Lord, our church has really never been the same. Our church has been led by Brother Randy Hardiman, Brother Ralph Easterwood through these years to always be a mission-minded church. And we thank you, Lord, that one of the first missionaries that we ever supported was Bob and Joan Tyson. And Lord, through these years, we have been blessed by their ministry in so many ways. And Father, today we are grateful, Lord, that she is in your presence. She's rejoicing. And Father, there's been a reunion going on now for a couple of days. And so, Father, we pray that we will, as friends and also for this precious family, they'll remember where she is, not where we are today. Because our hearts are saddened. We're sorrowful to see our dear friend, one of our heroes, the Lord that has left us. But at the same time, Lord, we know where she is, and we're grateful she's in your presence. Thank you, Lord, for the lives, thousands, if not even through the radio ministry, possible millions that will be reached because of the vision of Bob and Joan Tyson and their faithfulness. Now, Father, we pray for this service. We ask, Lord, that you will take this service, and that, God, that you will glorify yourself as Bob and Joan glorified you through their life and through their ministry. We also pray this service, Lord, will be able to, Father, to honor the life of this precious lady. And Lord, we thank you. Her suffering's over with. We ask now, Father, your blessing. May the Holy Spirit of God come. May you fill this room. May you minister to each and every heart. And may Jesus' name be glorified today. We ask this in Jesus' name, for Jesus' sake. Amen. Thank you.
for our iniquities. The chastisement of our peace was upon him, and with his stripes we are healed.
What a joy and privilege to be asked to sing at the homegoing of this saint. It's good to see all of you familiar faces. My goodness. God bless you all. Someday we're going to be right here with Sister Joan in the same situation. I hope you know him as your personal Savior.
They'd been tortured for the cause of Christ, yet peace was in their souls. For weeks they'd been in shackles that cut their hands and feet. from the horror of a Roman jail, for preaching in the streets, when suddenly the soldiers came and grabbed one of the brothers. Now he knew death was waiting out the door, yet he called.
Find any better singing than Jane Kill, Sandy Payton, and Missy Waldrop. Now, in the program, there is one thing's been left out that's very important. We've got Missy and Jason are singing, but Abby is also singing as well. Abby, you are in there too, girl. Abby's in there too. No, I'm not going to sing right now. We'll wait that a little bit later. I appreciate that. Thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you. All right. Well, for those of us who've had the privilege of knowing Miss Joan all these years, and Miss Sandy and Miss Jane have known her for lifelong friends. They're like sisters. They're like sisters. And a lot of experiences all of us have had the privilege of having with Miss Joan. And our mind goes back to a lot of things. And my wife and I first went down to Honduras in 1994. 2003, I think it was our first year that we went down there. And had been down there about 8 times since then. We were privileged in November of 2014 to go and to preach the graduations of that year. And that was the first time Miss Joan had been able to be back down there since she had gone through cancer and was going through cancer. And it was a very emotional time to be down there. The people were just could not wait to see Miss Joan. And wherever we went, people just gathered around her in groves. The school, the churches, the city, wherever we were. Stephanie and Steve and then were trying to keep her away and where she was very susceptible to getting anything at that time because of her resistance being down because of the chemotherapy. But Miss Joan, as she always did, threw caution to the wind, and she was grabbing people and hugging people and kissing on people and embracing those that her and Bob had given their lives to reach through all these years. There's a lot of things that we think of when we think of Miss Joan. I'm going to read some scripture, and I'm not going to take long. Pastor Randy Bell and Pastor Ralph are going to come and share the main messages today. But when I think of Miss Joan, I would thought of these verses here in these last few days. And I don't know of anybody that fits these scriptures any better than Joan Tyson. Apostle Paul is writing Timothy there in 2 Timothy chapter 4. And he says to Timothy, I am already being poured out as a drink offering. What that literally means is the drink offering was what would take place at the end of the sacrificial ceremony. And what Paul was literally saying was that he had poured out his life as a sacrifice for the glory of God. And that's exactly what Bob and Joan Tyson did all their life. They poured out their life as a sacrifice to the ministry of reaching men and women, boys and girls in Central America. And through the years, we've seen the testimony and the example of all of that. Paul went on and said, and the time of my departure is at hand. And we read that scripture, it gives us a picture, literally, of talking about how that a ship would be in the harbor and the ship would be untied from the mooring and would go out to its final destination. It's a picture of a military, a group of military individuals who had fought a battle and had won the battle. The battle is over, and they'd taken up the stakes of the tent and now are going home. Miss Jones' battle is over. Her battle is over. The tent has been pulled up. The ship has left the harbor, and she's gone home to be with the Lord. Paul said, I fought the good fight. I have finished the race, and I've kept the faith. When you think of somebody who is a good fighter, Miss Joan was a fighter. She gave it all she had. She fought to win people to Christ. She fought to live, to be able to continue to be with her family and influence them and love them and continue to lead them. She fought a good fight. But in every fight, there's some bruises. There's some pain along the way. Miss Joan experienced a lot of pain in her life when she lost Brother Bob. She, as a faithful wife, and our church back in the late 60s was fortunate enough and blessed to be able to be the first church that took them on as missionaries. Joan had come, they'd gone to other churches, and he was even preaching Sunday about how God takes individuals and will make a beautiful thing out of their life. And how that he took a country boy from Rossville, Georgia, and his wife, and God raised them up to reach thousands, if not millions, in Central America. And Bob had gone to churches and had tried to get people to support him, and nobody had supported him. And he was so discouraged when he came to Glen Haven back in those days. And they had a prayer time before the service as the missionaries were going to be speaking and sharing their vision and sharing what God had called them to do. And Brother Ralph went over to Bob and put his arm around him and said, "Bob, we're going to help you." And that was one of the greatest decisions Glen Haven Baptist Church has ever made, to be a partner with Bob and Joan Tyson and Good Samaritan Missions. But there's been some bruises along the way. He says, "I've fought a good fight, and I've finished the race." And Miss Joan finished her race. A race that is not a sprint. It's not a 50-yard dash, but it's a marathon. Actually, really, the race is more like an obstacle course a lot of times. We never know what we're going to face and what we're going to go through. But Miss Joan, and it says in this next phrase, "I have kept the faith." Because of her great faith, she was able to go over every obstacle and be able to defeat every situation that came her way and be able to go on and continue to do what God had called her and Bob to do. Think of the courage that took for her to do that. The courage it took for her when Bob was gone, that all of a sudden now all that was on her shoulders. But she never showed that stress to any of us. She just showed great faith. We can remember many times when she would say, "You know, God's given me a burden to do this," or "God's given me a burden to start this ministry or to do that ministry." And she'd say, "Now, I don't know where the money's going to come from, but we'll just trust the Lord. We'll just trust the Lord." And her faith was a faith that she just had seen God do so many things in their life. She wasn't afraid to step out by faith and trust God because she knew God was faithful. She certainly kept the faith. "Finally, there's laid up for me the crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, will give to me on that day, and not to me only, but also to all who have loved his appearing." And that's where she is. She's with him. She's heard the Lord say, "Well done, thou good and faithful servant." When we talk about the race that God called Bob and Joan to do, and we look at all the accomplishments of what God has allowed them to do these years, since they began their ministry, now over 238 churches are in Honduras and Nicaragua. They've trained pastors that pastors those churches and who have other mission churches they've started. In Honduras alone, there's 172 employees with Good Samaritan Missions in Honduras. There's another 37 employees in Nicaragua. There's 31 feeding centers that are feeding over 3,000 children every day in Central America because of Bob and Joan Tyson. And the feeding centers was really a burden and a passion for Miss Joan to start those feeding centers. Bob and Joan started the opportunity of a lifetime for children. There are 1,569 children in opportunity of a lifetime. Many of them are listening right now on live streaming. There's 256 dorm students that are there 24 hours a day that get three meals a day in continual care there. There are 189 sponsored children also in Nicaragua. We said 1,569 in that are in Honduras. But also there are 1,152 students in the schools in Honduras, beginning from kindergarten going through graduation. Miss Joan had a burden for the elderly center as well. Over 60 every day come to the elderly center and are fed every day. 200 of those who have come to the elderly center have passed away, but all 200 had made a profession in Jesus Christ before they died. We every time we would go down there, we'd go to the different center. We'd go to the churches and the feeding centers and all those things. But there was one event that stands out in my mind that just was a situation that I don't think I'll ever forget with Miss Joan. We were in the elderly center, and Mario, who drives all of us around, as you know. Mario is there, and so, as I said, I'm not good in Spanish. I'm not real well in English. But with Mario, we were all in there, and they were singing. I said, Mario, I want you to go to the store and get some candy. And Mario kind of looked at me like, I don't know what you're saying. And I said, you know, suckers. He said, ah. And so he takes off, and we're there in the Early Center, and I'm sitting in one of those rocking chairs next to Miss Joan, and my wife's on the other side of me. And so we're sitting there, and things are going on. And so in about 30 minutes later, Mario comes walking in the door with two big old huge bags that you can see through of soccer balls. Soccer balls. And so he walks in with these soccer balls in the elderly center. And Miss Jones said, Lord, what did you tell him, Brother Stan? I said, Miss Joan, I told him to go get some suckers. She said, oh, suckers. He thought soccer. And she just was dying laughing. And that laugh that she had, we loved that laugh she had. She had such a laugh that just brightened up the room. And so she had to go back and explain to Mario, we didn't want soccer balls. We wanted candy, suckers. And so Mario, got back, went back, and then he came back with candy on that. And so every time I see a soccer ball, I always think of Miss Joan. And I think of the elderly center. And I think of the soccer field that we need to build out there for them because of Mario's leadership there. They also have 11 radio stations that have been started through the ministry of this precious lady and Brother Bob and their family. Through those radio stations, over 4,000 people receive Christ that we know every year. Radio station in Tegucigalpa, the main radio station, receives over 600 phone calls a day. 600 phone calls a day. There's no way that we can really exhaust, and we could be here for hours telling about all the accomplishment of this precious lady, this great lady of great faith. A lady who just has touched all of our lives, and our lives are better because of Miss Joan and her influence on all of our lives. Seated right here to my right on these second and third rows are men and women from our Team Impact. We have a group of men and their wives that work with them, but men that go down every January, anywhere from 30 to 40 men go down to do repair work, to do construction work, to build and to be able to help the ministry of Good Samaritan Missions. They've done it now for many years. John and Angie Troutman helped lead this great ministry, and these are men and women who give up their own personal time, pay their own airfare to get down to Honduras, and all the money they raise at fundraisers. We just had one Sunday a week ago. All the fundraisers they do go to help pay for supplies on that. But these men and their wives have fallen deeply in love with Miss Joan as they've seen her and been inspired by her and heard the stories of how the ministry started and how God opened up doors in so many ways for the people in Honduras and Nicaragua. And so I'm very proud of these men and women. They make our church a better church. They're better church members after going to the mission field. And Miss Joan has had a great influence on their lives as well. And they're here today in honor of her also as well. I want to thank our choir. Half of them are not able to be here because they're at work, but I thank God for these who have taken off their time from work to be able to be here today to sing and to minister, because Miss Joan loved our choir and loved music. And we're honored today to have some of the best folks with Jane Kill and Sandy Payton to be singing for us today, as well as others also. When I think of Miss Joan, I think of her faith. I think of her fight. She fought to live and fought to do everything she could to win people to Christ. I think of her family that she lived for and loved with all of her heart. You've lost a prayer warrior that's prayed for you every day. She's called your name out to God every single day. And I know you're going to miss those prayers. I know you're going to miss her personality. I know you're going to miss her leadership. I know you're going to miss her smile and her words of encouragement. We all will. We all will. But oh, how she loved her family and how she was proud of y'all and loved you very, very, very much. It was precious a few moments ago to be back with the family and to hear from a couple of the nieces to share their influence. One of the nieces said that Miss Joan led her to the Lord when she was 14 years old. Others talked about that if she couldn't get a hold of her mama, another niece said, I'll call Aunt Joan. Whether she be here in Villa Rica or whether she be in Honduras, I could call my Aunt Joan and she could give me the advice, the encouragement that I needed. Well, we've been privileged to be able to know this lady all these years. She's blessed our life. We are a better church because of Bob and Joan Tyson. We have been able to learn more about missions through this couple. I do not know of any other mission program that to me is as advanced and complete as the work of Good Samaritan Missions. When you think of training pastors, when you think of reaching people with the gospel, and you talk about starting churches, and then those churches starting churches, one of the churches has 16 mission churches they started alone out of that one church. And when you look at all that's been done through that, and then the schools and the feeding centers and the elderly centers, it goes on and on, this ministry, and it will continue to go on and on for the glory of God. Thank you, family, for the privilege of letting me take part in this service, and we are honored to have this homegoing celebration here at Glen Haven. Our prayers are with you. We'll continue to be here for you and anything you need, and please call upon us. Our support will go to you just as much as it did to Miss Joan and Good Samaritan Missions. We love you and thank God for you today. God bless you.
The Son of God was laid in darkness. It's an honor and privilege to be able to sing and lead you guys in a worship song, Miss Joan's funeral. I've known Miss Joan my whole life. Miss Joan and Brother Bob came to my church when I was a little kid. It's probably 5 years old, I guess, when I first met them. And Stevie was still just a kid. And so I've known them all my life. We've been involved with Good Samaritan all life and just grown to love Stephanie and Stevie and the work there. And I've been privileged to take our family there. And Stephanie wanted this to be a time of worship, so if we can... If you guys will stand, we'll sing Holy, Holy, Holy. This is a song everybody will know. Holy, Holy, Holy.
Shall rise to thee, holy, holy.
Thank you, Brother Stan, for the good words. That's a blessing, thank brother. You, bless you. Buenos dias, Dios te bendiga. Good day, God bless you. San Juan 14, verso 12. I want you to turn your Bible to John 14, 12. Mary and I have known Bob and Joan Tyson for over 41 years. I was a deacon at a little country church in Carroll County. Hadn't been called to preach yet, and Bob came to our church. Wasn't too many people there. It didn't mind to him. He set up the old 16-millimeter projector, and with a black and white film without sound, he narrated it, probably frame by frame. And the cowboys in Palakawina rode with their horses and were trying to cut off the head of the chicken buried halfway in the ground in the middle of the road. And so there are some things you never forget in life. And then when after God called me to preach in 1980, then 3 months later I went to Riverside Baptist Church in Tallapoosa, and Bob and Joan Tyson were the first missionaries I called to come represent and let us have some missionary and do a mission work from the church. And they came, and the folks were all excited about it, supported them, helped them. And about 4 years later, then God called me back home towards Chattanooga, Tennessee, and I became the pastor there, Harmony Baptist Church, and Bob and Joan Tyson were the first ones I called to come and represent the mission, and the church fell in love with them, the work. The church was already helping around 30 missionaries, but they were the first ones I called. In 1989, Philip called me and said, I want you to go to Nicaragua with me. But my tenure with the family is way back before Stephanie was born, and Philip and Michael and Brandon. When I was pastoring in Tallapoosa, I was also teaching school, science and math, down at the Carrollton Junior High School, and pastoring. Someone asked me one time, Brother Stan, were you bivocational? I said, no, I was trivocational. I had three jobs, trying to put food on the table for our family and have a living as such. And oftentimes, Ms. Joan, well, Philip wanted to come back to the States and graduate from an American high school. And she called me up and said, could you tutor Philip in algebra? And I said, sure. I said, just come over any evening, make sure we're at home. And so oftentimes their car would roll up to our little home there on Gillette Drive there in Harrelson County. And Philip and I would go to the kitchen table and we'd go over his math homework, his algebra one homework, while Stephen was playing in the yard with my son Daniel and Mary and Joan sitting in the living room, and our two daughters playing at their feet in the living room with their dolls. And so our life goes back a long way, and Philip was just a young man, had radio stations going, and so he invited me down. The political climate had changed a little bit. We went into Esteli, North Nicaragua, there for a campaign. Philip had gotten a hold of a gospel tent, set it up, and we're preaching 5 nights a week during the day, going out and visiting churches. And you know one thing about the Nicaraguan churches that Bob taught them, as he did the Honduran churches? Everyone win one, and every church start one. And that was just a beginning. Many have done more than that. And then we took one day and went across the border into Honduras. And there in Honduras, at the Mount Calvary Baptist Church, the Good Samaritan school students were lining the street, Pan American Highway, with American flags and Honduran flags, and greeted us as we came into the church. One song they sung there that we could not sing in our schools in America, they sang in English, God Bless America. And what a great blessing it was. And so there are precious memories. I could go on. When I left Harmony, we were helping the mission out, and then I went to Lupton Drive by the call of God. And after 2 years of getting things on the ground there, then I took a mission team there to Honduras and Nicaragua. And when they came back, I did not have to sell them at all on the work of Good Samaritan Baptist Missions, because when they came back, they told everybody what they saw. And if you've never had opportunity to go, let me invite you to call our office manager, Ms. Rebecca Day, and see when you can go down there and just see for yourself what has God wrought. What has He brought to pass? My memories are many of Sister Joan. She was like an older sister to me. I'm a little bit younger than she is or was. And our relationship sort of lined up as brother and sister in Christ, but also like a part of the family. She would call me, and I let her know at any time she needed my help. If I could pull away, I'd be there to help her, and I've fulfilled that commitment to her, amen, with great satisfaction. And we sure will miss Miss Joan in this life, but we're not looking at the past. We're looking more at the future, how beautiful heaven must be because she is there. I want you to stand with me. You've been sitting a moment. Stand with me, please, and let's read the scripture, John 14, 12. St. John 14, 12. Verily, verily, I say unto you, he that believeth on me, the works that I do, shall he do also, and greater works then these shall he do, because I go unto my Father. Heavenly Father, bless thy word this morning. Bless Sister Joan's family, her friends. Lord, this wonderful church that has sent them and backed them. Father, we thank you for them. Lord, meet the need now, Father, in the words I speak and the words Brother Ralph will speak later. Christ's name I pray. Amen. Thank you. You may have a seat. Now, if you're sitting near a friend or a loved one, turn to them and say, I love you. Might solve a few marital problems, Stan, while we're here. I'm not sure. Oh. Michael, where you need to interpret, Brother Michael Tyson, when you need to interpret for our brothers, do so when you feel like you need that, okay? One morning, God, many years ago, directed a little boy to bring 5 loaves and 2 fishes to the gospel meeting. Who's going to be preaching, his mother might have said. Well, it's that evangelist, Jesus of Nazareth. And when he went there, lo and behold, it was he that God used with those 5 loaves and 2 fishes. Many, many years later, a little girl told her mom probably she's going to a gospel meeting. And she said, Mom, I have nothing to eat. What can I take to eat? And the mother might have said, Daughter, we have nothing but a green grapefruit. And she said, I'll take it. Well, who's preaching the meeting? Well, it's one of those gringos, missionary Bob Tyson, Roberto Tyson. She went to that meeting, and at the end of that meeting, when the pastor and his wife offered Joan and Bob a bite to eat, not much, but much more than what they had, God touched Joan's heart, and her heart saw that little girl with that green grapefruit. And in that day was born the Feed the Hungry program. There, God spoke to her heart about helping those who did not have. Where Jesus fed one time 4,000 and another time fed 5,000 men, Joan Tyson, along with many believers and helpers, is now feeding 3,000 children, boys and girls, every day, 5 days of the week. And this is in fulfillment of the scripture that God said in John 14:12, he that believeth on me, the works that I do, he shall do also, and greater works than these shall he do. Jesus never fed 3,000 a day. He could have. But Sister Joan Tyson, in her heart, felt that, and she did it. Christ had at one time 70-something disciples, and later it dwindled down to maybe 12 and an inner circle of 3. Yet at the crucifixion there were none, except maybe John there. And Sister Joan Tyson, working with Brother Bob Tyson, set up the Bible Institute, where they have discipled for 3 years, the same amount of time that Christ had his 12 disciples, discipled preachers to preach the gospel throughout North Nicaragua, Honduras, even into Mexico, Puerto Rico, around. Now we have some in Spain preaching the gospel. Greater works shall you do, he said. And Sister Joan Tyson exemplifies this one verse in the Bible, that she did what Christ had prophesied, what he had promised. We are to go and do more for his cause. We think that Jesus only had one in his nursing home ministry, his mother, that he turned over to the Apostle John, John the Divine. And in her desire, when her mother passed away, the Holy Spirit again spoke to Sister Joan's heart about starting an elderly center. And now the people around San Marcos walk there, are brought by vehicles there. They are taught the Word of God. Our dear sister who heads up that ministry received some little conflict because of that. And some of the preachers thought it wasn't appropriate that she should be teaching men, older men. And she came to see Brother Bob one day, and Brother Bob told her, said, "You have some enemies." And Brother Bob was playing with her. And she says, "Who are they?" He said, "Well, some of the preachers said you shouldn't be teaching those older men." And she said, "Well, what did you tell them, Brother Bob?" And Brother Bob said, "I told them, okay, which one of you are going to do the work that she's doing?" And none of them volunteered. So, sister, you keep doing the work you're doing until we find someone better than you, but you are the best. And so here Sister Joan has a nursing home ministry greater than the Lord Jesus Christ. "These works you will do," he said, "and greater works than these shall he do, because I go unto my Father." We will not do greater miracles than what he's done. We cannot save people ourselves, but we can do greater works than what Christ was able to do in the short period he was there. The Lord Jesus Christ never started a school, yet Sister Joan Tyson, along with the help of other believers, has started several schools with the opportunity for a lifetime program by which to tell others about the love of Christ. What a great ministry, the schools, the educational system. In times past, the political candidates heard of the graduation in San Marcos, and one man who eventually became the president came and sat as a guest at the table, and after the meeting, he said, "This is the most wonderful educational program in our country, an opportunity for a lifetime." how wonderful that he is. And he gave all accolades, but like a politician, I don't know we gained much from his friendship that day. But Christ never started a school, but Joan did. Jesus spoke to hundreds on the Judean hillsides. And Sister Joan has spoke to millions over the radio network. Men and women, boys and girls, hearing the gospel. She's done greater works as Christ had prophesied. And what an inspiration for all of us here. Can we not do more for Christ because of what we've seen in this dear lady? Bob Tyson and Joan Costello Tyson were like a pair of oxen in God's yoke. Where he was faith, she was works. Where he was the black suit, she was the colorful spring dress. Where he was steel, she was the elastic. Where he was hot fire, she was the cool spring water. Where he was the fighting infantry, she was the MASH hospital coming up behind. Where he was the dominant ox, she was the submissive ox. Where he was the preacher, she was the teacher. Where he was the talker, she was the listener. Where he was the dreamer, she was the realist. Where are we going to get this money, Bob, to build this? She would say oftentimes. 1989, I've been in there probably 30, 35 times into Honduras and Nicaragua with the Tyson family. And when Joan was alive and Bob had a project going, we would be sitting eating, and maybe the four of us, Mary and I and Bob and Joan, and she'd look at Brother Bob and said, "Now, where are you going to get the money for that?" She was the realist. He was the dreamer. Where he was the sword, she was the needle and thread. Where he was the gold tried in the fire, she was the Proverbs 31 woman who was more precious than rubies. Solomon didn't say diamonds, because diamonds simply take light from another source and reflect it out. But the ruby has its own inner beauty, unlike other jewels. Our sister is in the presence of her loving God today. From the mountains of Sherwood, Tennessee, to the plateau of Comalí, Honduras, she's been faithful to her loving God. From the faith venture starting at Tennessee Temple College to the portals of heaven, she's been faithful to her husband and to her God. Of the people she has met since being in heaven these few days, I wonder if she's met the dear missionary lady who gave her pictures of children in China that she was helping and who wrote her letters back and forth. I would have loved to have heard that conversation of how Joan met her and the love she had. May God bless you. Thank you for being here on behalf of the family. God bless you.
A couple of Sundays ago, Abigail and I went down and spent the day with Joan in the hospital. It was a rough day. We went with her as they transported her to Carrollton. I came home. was in the studio recording this song, and it just seemed as though Joan came in the room with me. It seemed as though we were talking over the song, and all heaven fell, and it seemed like she was singing the words that I was trying to put on a CD. It's a simple song. The Lord has been praised today, and Joan has been honored. But maybe this is just two ladies having a conversation as she's looking just over the horizon. On that day, they were putting her on life support as I was singing. I've journeyed a lifetime in search of a city, a haven of rest for my tired soul. By faith I can see it just beyond horizon, and what I can tell, it sure looks like home. The winds of temptation, they'll not blow against me. Grains of defeat, they've never had and they never will beat on my face. And I'll not run for shelter, oh, but I'll be safe forever. Nothing for being in that room with me that day and giving a moment to me that I'll never forget. I love you, sister.
Amen. It takes a long ways to get to the pulpit now. When I was preaching, I didn't have to walk this far. Amen. All right. Thank you, Bob. You laugh at everything I say, buddy. I'll buy you lunch. Preachers have these tall water bottles, and you look at it and you say, my Lord, is he going to preach that long? I went to Kroger, and I got this one for y'all's benefit. See here. See, it's not a whole lot. Because I felt if I got one of them tall bottles out, y'all would get up and leave, man. When you're the oldest person around, you've been here the longest. Does that make sense? Would you amen that? When you're the oldest person around, boy, I like my upper, that hair, that looks pretty good in the back of there. You've been around the longest. Does that make sense? Could I have an amen to that? And so next year our church will have the 70th anniversary, and I'll have my 50th anniversary in ministry. Well, 48 years of that has been involved with the Tysons. That's amazing. 48 years of that has been involved knowing them. During the Jubilee, Bob did come in and prayed very pitifully in that prayer room. I mean, buddy, he was brokenhearted. Nobody was helping him. He even went to one person's house to go to their church, and they went to church and left him at the house. That's crazy. He said, Brother Ralph, they left me at the house. They didn't invite me to go to church. And one church he went to was the wrong church. They wasn't even expecting him. And so they didn't recognize him. He just left. So he was pretty exasperated. Is that a good word? Exasperated? That's my learning from high school. Okay. And so then when he come to Glen Haven, he was down. And he come in that prayer room and got to pray. And it's the most pitiful prayer I ever heard in my life. He's over there crying out, said God's not helping him. And I didn't know who he was. I just knew he was a country-talking, red-headed fella that was sort of fiery. So went over there, and little did we know when we talked to him about support, what it would be. And then when it's in language school, me and Larry Ferguson went down there, and he was really struggling with the language. I mean, that wasn't North Georgia language, you know, Roswell language. And Bob was struggling. Joan's doing pretty good, so there's down, and we had a little revival meeting down there, and it really helped Bob. And you know the old story, when the language teacher told him to roll his R's, speaking Spanish, go like a roll R, said, make a noise like you do when you're playing with your car out back. Bob said, budden, 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 budden. That was his, that's the way he played with his cars. So we know that story, you know. And then we had a great time with them in language school, and they'd been praying for children all these years and hadn't been able to have them. And me and Miss Gwen never had that problem. I mean, we started right out with our family pretty quick, but then Philip come along. Right after they went to language school, she become pregnant with Philip, and the Lord blessed her with a child because they'd left everything. I mean, she was a great accountant in the company. Bob had a great job. They walked away, sold everything, left everything, and sold out and went to the mission field. And there wasn't a lot of missionaries around like them because Bob, what I call this cornbread fella, I mean, he just get down to business with you, and Mr. Joan would too. They're just down-to-earth people. And so by being that way, some other missionaries didn't approach their mission fields like Bob and Joan did. And so the board they was with, there was some little criticism, and one of the leaders criticized when I was on one of the trips, and I didn't like that. I thought Bob doing a great job, and Joan doing a great job, and they got critical of him. Well, Bob finally just said, I'm just going to start my own mission board. He said, I'm going to walk away from them, and I'm going to do it like I think it ought to be done. Well, we were the first church also that picked them up then when they started Good Samaritan Missions because we felt like Bob was doing it right. He believed in just getting in there with them, being folks with them. If they had a death, he'd build a casket for them. If they needed food, he'd give them the last food in his house. He'd do anything. And the people, and Joan did the same thing. And so the people loved them because they was down to earth with them. And they were very unusual missionaries and did an awesome job. In my involvement, I was in mission conferences with him in many different places all over the Southeast, revivals, vacations. We was in Gatlinburg having a great time, went over a embankment, guy hit us, went down in the creek together. Jones broke her arm, broke my hand, bobbed up. Miss Gwen got bruised up, and so we was in a wreck together in Gatlinburg. And so that sort of drew us a little bit closer to each other. All right, that's right. And many trips to Nicaragua, Honduras, and I took groups down through Central America. Start out in Mexico, and then go to Guatemala and Salvador and Costa Rica, and then see, I almost sound Spanish when I say that, Costa Rica, you know. So I can't speak Spanish, but I can say adios, señor. All right, okay. And so we would. And so with all that, but I had to save Bob and Joan's ministry to the last. Because if you took them first, the rest of them would be sort of a downer. Sort of a downer. You agree with that, sir? Randy, amen, Randy. Well, bless your heart, brother. You're a good man. All right. And you had to put them on the last of the list because when you went through Good Samaritan and you went through Nicaragua, like I said, it's sort of like a Nicaragua and Honduras, when you did that, that was the best mission field you could go to. So we learned how to do that. So we had a lot of involvements with them, and I was in a missionary conference with him one time, and I'd preach, and Bob would show the slides, and he always messed up with his slide projector, something that always happened to it. But we was in a morning service. They had no curtains on the windows, nothing, and there's so much light in there, you couldn't see one of those slides on that screen. You couldn't see it. And I said, what is he going to do? Well, he just described what the slide represented. He'd say, now, if you could see this slide, this is one of our first churches that we planted over there. And then he'd say, now, if you can see this slide, this is where we're crossing the creek in the van, and it broke down. And then here's some of the first people that we won to the Lord. He went through that entire slide presentation, and we couldn't make out one thing on the screen. And then I had to preach after that, you know. Bob had red hair, and his hair started getting thin, and he knew I had hair. He said, where'd you get your hair? I said, I bought it. He said, is it your hair? I said, you better believe it. I bought it. It is mine. So I bought him a toupee. I thought he'd appreciate it. Well, he stuck it on, and it looked pretty good. It was red, but he got to whacking on it with scissors. You do not cut a toupee with scissors. It does not grow very fast. He whacked it up, got it all butchered up, and then he run out of double stick tape. See, I got double stick tape on this morning. I got my he got it on his forehead, and he got in one of those real houses, real hot summertime in a wedding. And Bob is sitting there, and he's trying to read the vows to the people, and he started sweating, and that booger started coming down over his face. And he was doing like this and trying to marry these folks, and he finally just pulled the thing off and stuck it in his pocket. He said, forget it, Brother Ralph. It don't work for me, all right? The world don't understand how you can laugh at a funeral. The world don't understand that. Let's say this is sacrilegious. This is ridiculous that you are laughing at a funeral of a person, that they're dead and they're gone. Yeah, they're gone. We don't know exactly where they've gone to, and we know exactly where they are, and Joan's a whole lot better off than any of us right now. But when you have humor in a time like this, it lets us know that our hope is built on nothing less than Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. For on Christ, the solid rock, I stand. All other ground is sinking sand. Bob and Joan were different. They had different temperaments. Y'all did know that, don't you? Bob was a driven, visionary, disciplinarian, strong, red-haired country boy with a temper. Bob get upset at times. And I can describe him because that's my sort of my nature, too. I can get upset at times. But him and I being together, we couldn't both get upset at the same time. One had to calm down the other. He'd get upset, and then somebody had promised him some money. I said, Bob, that looks good. He said, I'll believe it when I hear the scratching on the check. He said, Brother Ralph, I had so many people to promise me money, and says, I just don't believe it no more. And that was the title of our message when we had his homecoming service, the scratching on the check. And so Bob, but you know, and he was a hard worker, but he married the right woman. Amen? All you fellas married, as you say, I married the right woman. I'm going to help you with your marriage too. I married the right woman. I married somebody different than me. If I'd have married somebody like me, we wouldn't have never made it, I'll tell you right now. Bob was the caloric, outgoing temperament, the driven person. Joan was the laid-back person, you know, that could have the calming effect. She was calm. She was cool. She was collected. She was credible, had some of the best records. The IRS said they'd never seen the tax records like she had, tremendous records. She was very courteous. Joan was nice to everybody. She was very charitable, and she was very courageous in all the places she lived. But if we had to have a word to describe Joan Tyson, she was compassionate. Of all the things you can say about her, of knowing her for almost 50 years, of being with them on vacation, being with them in different places, being with them many times fellowshipping and going places and doing things and being in meetings, if there ever was a woman married to a missionary that had the great attribute of being compassionate, Joan was the queen of compassion. Would you say amen to that? It'll help you stay awake and you won't get so hungry, all right? Amen. She was the queen of compassion. And you look up compassion, it means feelings of mercy. She was a merciful woman. And it wasn't that Bob wasn't, but Bob was a driven fellow. He got the work done. He loved people. But Joan was the salve that they sort of put on when Brother Bob, maybe he was very forward. He got the work done. He loved people. He's a hard preacher, a good preacher. And Joan was the perfect combination for Bob's personality. Just like Miss Gwen is the perfect combination for my personality. Would you say amen to that? Amen. All right. You better, all right, because I ain't going to marry nobody else. Okay, all right. And when you look at it, mercy is compassion shown to an offender, or blessings resulting from divine favor or compassion. Compassion is shown to victims of misfortune. I look on compassion as being described as passion compounded. You think that, amen? I'll get through quicker if you'll amen, all right. Passion compounded. She was so full of passion compounded. As you look in the Word of God, there's 40 references to compassion. 20 in the New Old Testament, 20 in the New Testament. Brother Ed Below taught me years ago, go to the first reference of a word and see what it means, and it carries tremendous meaning. Did you ever hear Brother Ed Below say that? A preacher, go to the first mention in the Bible? Amen. How about that, Brother Randy? How about that, Brother Stan? All right, okay. Don't disagree with me up here, fellas. Amen. I'm just kidding. But the first reference that you look into it is Exodus 2 and 6. As Pharaoh's daughter looked at baby Moses, and as she looked at baby Moses in the ark, she saw the child as the baby wept, and she had compassion on him and said, "This is one of the Hebrews' children." Compassion, the first time it's mentioned in the Bible, a lady looks out and realizes a slave, a one that was looked down upon in that time. But she looked at little Moses, and with compassionate love, she knew she needed to take him in. She was following out the Lord's perfect will in the life of Moses, and she took him in, even though he was one of the Hebrews' children. Right. first mentioned. Then Psalms 85, 15 says, but thou, O Lord, are full of what? Say it. Compassion. But thou, O Lord, are full of compassion and gracious long-suffering and plenteous in truth and mercy. Then you move into the New Testament, Matthew 14, 14. And Jesus was moved with what? Say it. Say it. Moved with what? Compassion as he healed their sick. Matthew 15, 32. To the disciples, Jesus said, I have what? Compassion on the multitudes because they continue with me. Then 1 Peter 3 and 8, finally be of one mind, having what? Compassion one of another. And so if you're going to really describe Joan Tyson in all that she was and all the years of being a good teacher and the one that reached out to the children and one that reached out to the preachers and one that reached out in every direction of ministry, you'll have to say the one word that describes her more than any other word is the compassion and the love that she had for others. And she wanted to reach out and be the instrument in God's hand to be a blessing to them. Remember all the years that we were around her. I don't remember any time that Joan Tyson ever was a negative person. I don't remember any time she ever talked down about something. Now, me and Bob, sometimes we'd get upset about something. We went to a mission conference one time, and I preached, and Bob shown slides, and we was there all week long. And then the preacher called us in and said, we got to have a meeting because I need to call some mission board to find out if he knows of any missionaries we ought to support. Bob looked at me and said, why have we been here all week? He's going to call another mission board to see who. Now, Bob got upset about that. And, you know, and I would have, but we couldn't both be upset at the same time. Say, he said, Brother Ralph, I don't understand this. This man, we're here. We got mission works. We got all kinds of stuff he needs to support. He wants to call somebody else to see what missionaries he might support. So, see, the Lord really allows you to go through some trials in mission work. But Bob always, and Joan would help tone him down. She'd help get him back to thinking right and help get him guided right. That's what Miss Gwen has done for me all these years. She helps get me back in the right position to where God can bless me. Been married 63 years now, and I ain't going nowhere. Amen. I'm going to stay with her. I got on my alligator shoes this morning. And she gave me these alligator shoes. And I said, please, honey, do not give those alligator shoes to your new husband when I die. And she stood up in church and says, I won't because they're not his size. So, Brother Stan, if I go for you, you cannot have these, buddy. They won't fit you, all right? Okay, that's an old joke. Thank y'all for laughing. I have more fun with that. And so Joan was a lady that was full of compassion. It says, Matthew 15, 30, the disciples, Jesus says, I have compassion on the multitudes. Why? Because they continue with me. She was a consistent servant of the Lord all these years, year in, year out, through sickness, through heartache, through heartbreak, through problems, through trials, through valley decisions that she had to make. We walk through those valleys, those valley experiences that we have. That draws us closer to the Lord. Yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. So with so many valleys that she went through, Joan always had that compassion. 1 Peter 3 and 8, finally be of one mind, having compassion, what does it say? One of another. Bob and Joan had great churches on the mission field. She fulfilled and made all that Bob was, helped it be complete in the Lord. You know, when the Lord created man, that's the only thing he said, it wasn't good. He said he wasn't complete, he needed someone else. And he sent him that helpmate to make him complete. And that's what happened in Bob's life. When he was wanting someone to spend the rest of his life, he sent to him Joan to be a part of a ministry all these years that would have to courageously carry it on even after Bob was called home to be with the Lord. And then Psalms 111:4, He hath made his wonderful works to be remembered. The Lord is gracious and full of compassion. The scripture says he's made his works to be remembered. And the memories that we have, all of these 48 years of so many experiences, so many souls being saved, so many miracles being wrought on the mission field that Joan and Bob could tell us about it. And Joan was the ultimate storyteller. All these men, you just sat around like kids in kindergarten while Joan told you stories about missions, wouldn't she? She'd just keep our attention, because she could so eloquently tell them. No one had a voice and a way of saying things just like Joan Tyson. When I walked away from that hospital the other day, realizing that that voice had been silenced forever as far as this world is concerned, I told Gwen, I said, you realize we're not going to hear Joan's voice no more. We're not going to hear that sweet way she would say things to us and just tell us things and just hold us spellbound, telling one experience right after another. And I said, darling, for the first time in 50 years, Joan's gone. And I had a sort of a sad, pitiful moment there for a little bit, you know, because I was living in the temporary. It's so easy to live and exist and be happy in the temporary. Folks, we're in the temporary. A big T is over every one of our lives. We're just passing through. We're just a pilgrim in this world, and we're just passing through just a very short time. Well, we're getting prepared for all eternity, and there we'll spend in the presence of the Lord. To be absent from this body is to be present with him. Precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his saints. Heaven cries out, precious, 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 precious. When Joan come into his, the other day we were crying in the last few seconds of her life, and it was tough, and I know the family was weeping, but heaven was saying, precious, precious, precious is the sight of a loss of a sinner being saved by the grace of God coming home. And her and Bob had a reuniting, amen, and with all those that's gone on before them. And so it says, be of one mind, having compassion. And it says, Psalms 111:4, he hath made his wonderful works to be remembered. And folks, we want to remember, and we want this mission to go on and even supersede anything that's ever happened. Jude 22, the last time that compassion is mentioned. And of some having compassion, making a difference. Making a difference. Amen. Through Honduras and Nicaragua and in many other places in the country, in Costa Rica and even in Mexico, where Brother Stan was down there with Brother Vidal just the other day. Good Samaritan Missions has made a difference. Amen. Made a difference in the lives of thousands of people through radio ministries, through the feeding centers, through what Brother Stan all called out, making a difference. In the lives of people to where they have been touched by the wholeness of God. They've been convicted by the Spirit of God. They've confessed their sins and been saved in redemption and been born again by the very Lamb of God who gave his life on Calvary's cross that we might be saved, that we might eternally be with him for all eternity in glory with Jesus. Joan Tyson, along with Bob, even before 4 years, in the last few years, has truly been able to make a difference. But how can we continue in this? How can we continue making a difference? Matthew 9:36. You might want to look at this in your Bible. Matthew 9:36. But when he saw the multitudes, he was moved with what? Say it. Say it again. He was moved with compassion on them because they were fainted and were scattered abroad as sheep having no shepherd. Then saith he unto his disciples, the harvest truly is plenteous and the laborers are few. Pray ye therefore the Lord of the harvest, and he will send forth the laborers into his harvest. And so, dear people, a compassionate lady has left behind a tremendous ministry that will need a lot of people to step up and step in and take over and move on in the ministry that Bob and Joan Tyson gave their lives for. Would you say amen to that? I wrote a little poem. I haven't wrote one lately. My wife don't even know it unless she peeked at my notes. I'm a poet. Old fella says I'm a poet. I got big feet to show it because I'm a long fella, you know. That's an old joke. You'll get that if you think about it, all right? But to Sister Joan, a lady of compassion, a great lady of love and care who carried many burdens she was called to bear, a wonderful companion and wife of a dedicated man who followed him faithfully as they carried out God's plan. Through the many years of ministry, trials, and demands, she proved to all that she possessed a biblical faith that surely stands. To meet a challenge of a world seeking a more secure life, and she fulfilled this ministry with Brother Bob as his God-called loving wife. After Brother Bob left us through God's will of his eternal grace, Sister Joan and her family, workers and friends continued on at their mission anointed pace to accomplish all of the Lord's ministry in this continuing spiritual race. Now, Sister Joan is finally at her heavenly home with her preacher man, Brother Bob, and both can face their Savior as they proclaim they accomplished the glorious job of leaving a wonderful ministry to family, workers, and friends as the task will be continued to reach the multitude. But on whom does this depend? Surely on those who remain that love the Lord and this spiritual pair. Two folks we will always remember because they showed us how to care for the downtrodden, poor, and lost on the mission field, and it shall be done. If our hearts, minds, and lives are dedicated to His purpose as we witness of God's only begotten Son. The Lord spoke to my heart to write that in honor of Joan Tyson. And I wanted to close out like this. Stephanie, I want you to come up here, honey. If there was ever a love light in Joan's eyes all these years, was this granddaughter. And she is one of the sweetest ladies. She's turned into a beautiful, beautiful lady. Would you say amen to that? Amen. You better. All right, okay. And she has been taught just about all her life to step into this position and to be the lady that would step into the shoes of Joan Tyson to carry on this ministry. Amen? And she's very intelligent, beautiful lady, hard worker, and God has prepared a person. We may can't hear Joan's voice, but we can see through Stephanie Joan Tyson. The rest of her life, we'll see Joan, and you're your own lady too, I realize that. But Joan Tyson loved that mission enough to love this granddaughter and teach her week after week, hour after hour, year after year. Steve, come up here. Steve, radio ministry that Brother Philip started years ago that reaches thousands of people. Steve is a very humble, sincere, dedicated man. Come on my side over here, pal. Come over here, right here, all right? I don't want y'all on each side of me, all right? I may fall down. Y'all can hold me up, okay? Those pastors love him down there. He's interpreted for me lots of times, but they love him. And he'd be working with Stephanie and taking on the responsibilities more and more, that this mission may grow, that this mission may go, and this mission may glow. How you like that, brother? To go, grow, and glow. If you use it, you give me credit for it. All right, okay. To glow for the glory of God. I want all the family and all the workers to come and stand right down at the front in front of those flowers. If you're a worker, you're a pastor, family member, I want you to come stand right down here. Y'all, come on. Come on. I'm speaking in English. Y'all understand English. Come on. And those that don't, tell them what to do. Amen. Bring them right down here. All right. I want you to stand right down here. I want you to face the audience. Okay, face the audience. I want you to face the audience. These are workers. These are pastors. Is anybody else that's connected directly? Then I want this impact team to get on the end of them. Come on, impact. Come on. You're going down there every year. You're putting out all kind of work. Put on the end down there. Let's get you on both ends. Let's get you on both ends. Boy, they have helped that ministry. They've been a blessing of that ministry and all that. And get on in here. All right, okay, here. All right, line on up. Get on both sides. I want you to be balanced out. There's more black shirts over here than there is over here. Amen. Let's get them over there. I call them Glen Haven's Mafia. All right? They're doing good. All right. All right, there they are. All right. This is your new appointed God call leaders. Come on, Brother Randy. You get up here too. You're on the board. Come on, Randy. This is your anointed God call leaders of this ministry. Joan Tyson did all she could do, as long as she could do, as well as she could do. But she's not here no more. And you never want her back in that failing body that she went on to be the Lord and left here. This body wore out. This body wore out. So you don't go to cemeteries thinking you're talking to them there. You look up to heaven and pray to Jesus. Amen. And you're looking up. That's where they are. They're not Amen. Down there, and they're not off in a hole in the ground, right? Right. Right. And so here are the workers. Here's this impact team. Is anybody else that's connected directly with the ministry? All right. What the pastors that's here, if you've led your church to support them, you come down and get down here. If you're a pastor and you're involved in this support, come on down here. Any pastors down here, okay? Come on down here. Come on down here, pastors. We got some more board members. And some board members. Come on, board members. Come on, board members. Come on, board members. Get on down here. Preachers are stubborn. You have to tell them 4 or 5 times to do something, amen. But see, I'm older than every one of you, so I can be y'all's boss, all right? Come on. All right, get on down here, all right? Come on, Brother Jimmy. All right, come on, pastors, get on down here, all right. This is an army. This is a group that are forceful and spiritual and love Jesus and love this ministry. Amen. Brother Stan, I want you to come up here. You're the senior pastor. And Brother Stan, I want you, and Brother Stan loves this ministry. Yes. Brother Stan's done a great job here. Amen. Since I've been retired, and this church has grown. Brother Stan, I want you to get right over here in the middle. Get right in the middle. See, I make him do what I want him to do right here because I'm in charge. He's the boss most of the time. Amen. All right. And Brother Stan, I want you to pray Amen. For this new leadership Amen. That'll be with this board, that it'll go smooth, Amen. That we'll have compassion on people like it Bob and Joan did, Amen. That we'll have compassion on each other, that we'll love each other and work in harmony and love and respect these two that's going to be leading along with the board and all the workers. Amen. But I want you to pray a prayer of dedication and commitment for them today, my brother.
All right. Okay. All right. Let's pray. Lord, we truly, Lord, today are humbled by your Yes. call on all of our lives. And Lord, when we see what Bob and Joan, Lord, when they surrendered to your call, and God, what you have done through them and continue to do now through their children and grandchildren. And Father, we pray, God, that, Lord, you will continue to mold and to make, Lord, Stephanie and Steve, the man and the woman they need to be, Lord, to continue, Lord, to lead this ministry. We ask, God, for your Holy Spirit to rest upon them and put your hand on them. And we ask, Heavenly Father, you continue, Lord, to help them to remember, Father, the compassion and the grace and the work ethic, Lord, that was laid before them by Bob and Joan. I pray, Heavenly Father, at the same time that, Lord, you will encourage them to know, Father, that all the family and all these who are involved, there's so many that are at work to make this ministry what it is. That, Father, that each and every one, Lord, will make a promise to you, but also, Lord, a promise to one another to love one another, to bless one another, to support one another, to encourage one another, Lord, to continue to do, Lord, your will, and continue to build the ministry, God, that you began through Bob and Joan. We pray for the board and those that are on the board, Father, continue, God, to give them wisdom and leadership as well as they encourage this team also. Thank you for the men and women from our church, Lord, of Team Impact, and Lord, the burden and the passion they have, Lord, to be a blessing to this ministry as well. So, Father, we ask, Lord, you continue, Lord, to do above and beyond anything we could ask or think, Lord, through this ministry. We pray, God, that those 268 churches will grow to be 500 to 1,000 churches. We pray, God, that these students, Lord, of over 1,150 students in the school would grow, Lord, to be, Father, thousands more. We pray, God, that the elderly center, the feeding centers, Lord, and everything else, Lord, that this ministry has been led to lead and begin and continue to do, that, God, you would multiply, Lord, the radio ministry outreach and everything else, God, beyond anything that anyone could ever imagine to do. Lord, thank you so much that, God, that Joan, through these last years also, has helped to pave the way and has helped, Lord, her family and Steve and Stephanie, Lord, to become the people they need to be, Lord. God, you gave them some very precious years here while Miss Joan was going through the cancer treatments, that they had to take on responsibility, Lord, and they had to take on leadership and do things. Thank you for a glorious plan, God, that you work out, and God, how you prepare our hearts for what you have called us to do. So now, Father, we pray, continue to anoint this ministry, and may your name be continually glorified and honored. Lord, may you continue to be pleased with what you're going to do through these folks, through this leadership team. Thank you so much, Lord. God, this is your ministry.
Yes.
It's not our ministry. It's yours. You began this. You started this. And Lord, we know, God, that faithful is he who calleth you, who also will do it. And so, Father, we thank you for what you're going to do through your children. We ask now your blessing upon these this time. Help us to keep our eyes on Jesus. Help us keep our eyes, Lord, on what you've called us to do, yes, on the men and women and boys and girls yet to be reached through this ministry, and we'll thank you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Everybody stay right where you are. Stand up, congregation. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now I'm found. Was blind, but now I see. Right before we sing that last verse, my pastor, Brother Randy, used to say, you know, it's not where you are now, it's where you're going to be 100 years from now.
That's right.
I like that.
Yes.
I like it. Don't you like that, little Randy? We got his son right back there with the patch on his eye. Yeah. I sing that last one. It brings that. When we've been there 10,000 years, bright shining as the sun, we've known
best days to sing God's praise than when we first begun. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Oh, how I love Jesus. Because He first loved me. Okay, Brother Stan. Thank you, sir.